Hi, welcome to Liquid Audio in Perth, Western Australia. Liquid Audio, cherishing classic audio. And for some reason, my audio did not record on this clip. So let me introduce the beautiful Krell KPS, or as I like to say, Krill, because it just amuses me to call Krell Krill. I don't know why, but the Krell KPS-30i CD player. Now, this beautiful CD player belongs to a customer of mine, a long-time customer of mine, and a very nice fellow. And he bought it, and it worked well for a while until it didn't. And it just stopped working. You know, you could turn it on, you could press on, and you could sort of, it would sort of power on, but there was no display, and it wouldn't play a disc, and it clearly was not well at all. So he asked me if I could take a look at it for him, and of course I said that I would. And so here we go, and we're going to have a quick look inside here, it looks like. I'm having to predict what I was saying at the time, so we'll take that cover off and let's have a look inside the Krell. There it is. So we've got a nicely laid out unit, and once again, Krell have spared no expense here. They've used some of their kind of, you know, I guess you'd call it industrial amplifier engineering in this unit, in the case of these TO3 regulators in the power supply. So we've got three regulated rails there. We've got a 5-volt rail and a high voltage rail pair, plus minus like 18 or something like that. Big transformer there for most of the player functions, and that tiny little transformer there, which will you'll see later become significant, that tiny little transformer is the one that actually ends up powering just the CD drive that we're looking at there, with its beautiful milled machined aluminium plate. And there we can see the board, and then there is the analog board, or the digital to analog board, with the analog output buffer. Some interesting stuff there, like some sort of FPGA or something. What is that? That is a DSP, in fact. It's a DSP, so probably some of the digital filtering and stuff is implemented in digital signal processor like that, a Motorola one in this case. And then we've got four Burr Brown PCM63K ladder type DACs, one of the very, very best of the old school resistive ladder DACs. They are in dual differential mode because we've got two fully balanced channels, is what I'm trying to illustrate here. We've got hot and cold in the left channel there, and hot and cold in the right channel there. And so we've actually got these DACs in a beautifully symmetrical arrangement there, with a beautifully symmetrically laid out output buffer. So this thing should sound really good. You'll note that there are lots and lots of tantalum capacitors in this thing. Now, people often mistakenly, because they read forums and guys go on about, oh, tantalum's no good. Tantalums actually are found in some of the most expensive gear on the planet. I can assure you, because I own some of it here in the workshop, in the lab, some of the very best HP, Agilent, Tektronix, etc. Some of that very most expensive gear you can buy is filled with tantalum capacitors. And it's because they do a particularly good job in a certain kind of a requirement. So for example, they have a very high capacitance per unit volume. They have good high frequency performance. But one of the problems with them though is that they tend to be very sensitive to over voltage. So these things, for example, let's just say that they're 30 volts. I can't remember what they are, 35 volts probably, right? If you run them at even a volt or two above that, they're likely to explode, or at the least become very leaky and then very conductive, and then they'll explode. So yeah, a couple of these have been replaced already. And as you'll see, I do go through and take out this board and, you know, sort of have a really good look at it. In fact, I tested every single one of those tantalums. And so we'll come to that. I'm probably giving some of this away. There's some cheap Chinese caps there. Someone's done some real cheap ass work on this and replaced those with goodness knows why they've used Chinese caps there. Why would you do that in a really, really good piece of gear like this? Well, you do it because you just don't have good parts in your inventory. And I'm sorry to say, that means you're not a good repairer. You need to have good parts in stock at all times so that you can just get something like this and just repair it. Now, you'll note this regulator. That's a 5-volt reg on the CD drive board, and it's literally just flapping around in its socket. Well, not its socket, but in its place on the board. in its holes there. So the pins are just loose in those vias, and you know, it's extremely hard for me to understand how this player even played a disc with, you know, a wobbly 5-volt regulator and some of the problems that it turns out that this machine has. Yeah, so as I suspected, you'll see that I'm just testing a cap there. It's leaky and very, very high ESR. It's these Philips axial capacitors. They're quite famous for failing in this way, and all of these need to be replaced. All these Philips caps that that feed the laser supply need to be replaced. So I'll have to sort of take this whole board out. I've got to take the mech out. I've got to take the drive out, and then not the drive, but the, you know, the sort of assembly that holds the mech, if you like, and it's all got to come out. All those caps have to be replaced, and obviously got to fix that regulator problem on the back of it as well. So yeah, we'll get onto this, and hopefully we'll make some progress. Okay, so here is the digital board out of the Krell KPS-30i, and as mentioned, we have a number of issues on this board, not the least of which is this. This is the, can you see the legs on this 5-volt regulator? Yeah, I wonder why that's not working. So there's that. That's one problem. But another problem is, let me just zoom back out. Another problem is this. Now, these are famous, these Philips caps. They're actually a good series of caps, but all of us who've worked on these players over the years think that there was probably a bad batch or something from Philips, because if you get a certain kind of player over a certain time frame, literally every one of these will be dead. And so they are in this player. Now, in this case, it's not every single one that's dead, but most of them measure just abominably bad, like 8 to 10 ohms ESR, leaky, low C. So obviously, they've all got to go. I'll replace them all with some nice Panasonic FM or FC, which will be much, much better for the power supply in this player anyway. And yeah, fingers crossed this will sort out the problem. But so we'll just do some, you know, some restorative work on this board, some repair work on a couple of aspects of it, and then we'll see if the player works after that. Okay, so the board is done. Now, those are the removed capacitors, and actually I was wrong. I said they weren't all dead. No, they are. They're all completely dead. There's not one of those that measures more than about 12 microfarads, so about half what it's meant to be, and all of them have an ESR of 4 ohms or more, some up as high as 8, 9, 10 ohms. So I've replaced them. You can see here, we've used some very nice Panasonic FM on all of these replacements. They're all super good parts. Definitely at least as good as the originals, but will last much longer than the originals. Higher spec, you know, better ripple current performance and things like that. So these are perfect for this laser power supply. These caps here I'm not replacing because they actually measure well. They measure and test well. And what I have also done, I've just cleaned up the board. It's not necessarily going to be that easy to see, but I've just defluxed the board, given it a nice clean, and it looks really good. There was a sort of a layer of crud on this board. Retouched a couple of dry joints, just defluxed it. So yeah, I might just test another couple of these caps actually, and then we'll put the board back in the player. Right, so I'm just reassembling the player. I have the main digital board back in. I have the suspension board back in, and I just thought I'd point out, I've just reinstalled the laser mech into this beautiful milled aluminium plate that combines the two together. Just thought I'd point out this laser mech was replaced recently by an official Krell authorized service agent. Nice of them to not route the wiring through the cable tie that's meant to actually be used. That cable stay is designed to sort of keep everything out of the way, and yeah, these were just floating around. They hadn't used that at all. So I'm going to reroute the cable through there to make sure everything's secure. Everything else looks good on this new mech. There are no problems. Then I'll put it all back together, and fingers crossed she's going to work. Well, I'm back, and after rebuilding this board and repairing problems with that voltage regulator and those capacitors that power the laser power supply, we still have a fault. Now, because all of those parts were broken or damaged, it was still important to replace them because the player just couldn't have worked properly as it was. So, in fact, it's been worthwhile to repair that board, but there is still a problem. So I've pulled out the analog board. I just wanted to see what was going on with this and possibly just repair a couple of things on this board as well while I'm at it, and see if we can't get any more of an idea of what's going on. There is something very strange going on with the power supply. I just haven't yet worked out what it is, and I will. And in the meantime, while I'm doing that, I'm going to have a really good look at this board and just make sure that everything on here is okay, because there is some, there's obviously some important control stuff. Actually, not control stuff so much, signal processing, I think, but there may be some control stuff on here, and there are multi-pin connectors, so I figured it was well worth just checking that all of those were okay and that everything sort of was making contact where it should. So we'll just continue and see what we find. Okay, so we have the analog, digital to analog board back in. What I did actually, I just needed to eliminate it actually as a source of trouble. So I treated the contacts underneath each of these connectors. And while I had the board out, I tested every single tantalum capacitor, because some of these have failed and been replaced. So I tested all of the tants, they were all okay. The other thing I did, I removed these two Chinese cheap-ass caps that someone had put in, and I replaced all of the electrolytics after discussing it with the customer. I had the board out, so it was literally just a few minutes of extra work to replace all of these with new Panasonic FM, just because the board's out, and that effectively refurbishes that board whilst we're, you know, searching for the cause of the trouble. So these capacitors were okay. Some of them were a little bit down on C, but you know, there was no major drama with these, but I've changed them anyway. We've got nice new caps here, and that will certainly improve the performance of the analog board. There's no question about that, but it won't have cured the problem, I don't think, and it certainly shouldn't have based on what I found, and I didn't change them for that reason. So anyway, I'm going to now power it up and see if we have any progress after pulling, testing, cleaning, and reassembling. Let's see how we go. Right, we're back here with the Krell. Now this really has been a bugger of a repair. Honestly, it's had me scratching my head, and look, I've been able to go through and do some other stuff that needed to be repaired that was incidental. In fact, what I have found the source of the problem. The source of the problem is this little transformer, which separately powers the digital board. The primary winding is open. In fact, it looks like the thermal fuse on this has opened. So yeah, that was a tricky one. I definitely didn't expect that, you know, but I guess no one expects that. Or to use a Monty Python phrase, no one expects the Spanish Inquisition. Yeah, so anyway, I've been in here peeling away the layers, which you can probably see. Right, just finished repairing this transformer. I've installed a new thermal fuse. I've done the best I can with it without having to take the transformer off the board. Very tricky, fiddly-ass repair, to be honest with you. And however, I believe, and I'm just about to test it finally again, but I think we've done it. We've got the new thermal fuse in there. I've got some insulation tape on the transformer now, and it's all pretty tight and secure, and I'm hoping that that will do the job. It does look perhaps not quite perfect, but you know, trying to get a new one of these transformers, just forget it, it's just not happening. So we shall make a few notes. I'll take a few voltages, seeing as we don't have that information from Krell. It's very important info, so we'll get some of that, and I will add that to the service data that I have, and then we'll get this thing back to the owner. Okay, and very briefly, we are going to just verify that the lovely KPS-30i now works. Look at that. It's got to have one of the sexiest displays I think I've ever seen on a piece of gear, and it doesn't even quite come out as beautifully rich red as it really is. But anyway, you can kind of see that, you know, it's responsive to controls, and you know, all of this kind of stuff is working nicely. Yeah, look, very, very happy. It's come out well. Now, the upshot of this, or the, I guess, the side effect or side benefit, is that we have really overhauled the player at the same time as repairing the transformer. So, you know, the CD drive board had a number of dead caps. These are all the parts that I pulled out of this Krell. Bunch of caps. A lot of these caps were okay, but while I was in there, I decided that it was prudent, after discussing with the owner. He agreed that he'd like me just to replace, because there weren't actually that many caps to replace in this. So I just did it while I had those boards out. And I improve them. I use better parts. So it will make a small improvement to the sound quality. It'll make a big improvement, the stuff we did to that CD drive board, though. Those caps were all literally dead. I can't believe that the player even played a disc like that. And with that loose voltage regulator, I don't know if you remember that voltage reg at the back that was literally flopping around in the board. So in fact, made some really good improvements. This player will certainly sound, I would suggest, 100% better than it has done for at least the last decade. Certainly, it'll sound a lot better than it has since this particular owner has owned the machine. So, yeah, very, very happy with that. Player is working well, and let's get it back to her owner. Now, if you'd like me to look at your Krell CD player or any other CD player for that matter, I do look a lot of CD players here at Liquid Audio. If you'd like me to look at yours, I'd be very happy to. Just get in touch with me via my website, liquidaudio.com.au. Thanks for watching.